So to start this video, let's have a look at some of the settings on the Vellum Fluid node and the Vellum Solver that are relevant to fluids. And let's start off with the Vellum Fluid node. I've already mentioned that you can set viscosity and surface tension here. So I've set that for both of those here. And let's just play through and see what that looks like. Let me put the display flag on the end there. And you can see it's a much sort of heavier, slower fluid compared to when those are off. That's with them off. You can also multiply the values of the Vellum fluid viscosity and surface tension here on the advanced tab, fluid subtab. You've got multipliers here for viscosity and surface tension that multiply the values set on the individual particles. If you've got surface tension and viscosity, and indeed in any case where you want to improve the quality of your simulation, you can increase the number of substeps, and generally you'll want to do that in order to produce a better simulation. There are two other things you can do to control the way the simulation works. By the way, this smoothing iterations here is not relevant to fluids. So if you've only got a fluid in your scene, you don't have a cloth or other type of vellum object, you can turn that down to zero. What you can do to affect the simulation is use velocity damping, and you want a really small value in here. Even something like 0.5 will make quite a noticeable effect. You can see how much slower the fluid is moving because of that velocity damping. But if you've got too much splashing in your simulation, then a bit of velocity damping can help. The other thing that you can do here on the Advanced tab, Motion subtab, is look at max acceleration. So the higher this value is, the more energetic your simulation is, the more splashy it's likely to be. The lower it is, the more sedate it's going to be. So let's put this down to 10 and see what happens. Well, it's a bit difficult to tell, but that is running slightly less energetically than it was before. So those are some of the main settings on the Vellum Solver. Let's now look at a few examples of using the Vellum Fluids with both interacting with other Vellum Fluids and with other types of Vellum Object. So I'm carrying on from the last example in that first video, which is the sourcing into a glass. And all I've done here is duplicate the sphere and move it across, and then create a fluid from that extra sphere, merge the two constraints and the two geometries together so that we get fluid sourcing from both spheres at once. So the interesting thing is, of course, to vary these two fluids. And this is the new feature in Vellum Fluids, which is to use the phase control here to give each of these two fluids a different phase. This one is phase one, this one is phase two. Let me change some other things here. I'm going to reduce the density of this one, and I'm going to set it to a very low viscosity. And for this one, I'm going to keep the density at 1000, and I'm going to put the viscosity up. So now we've got two fluids with different properties, and because the phases are different, the solver is going to treat them as two independent fluids that'll mix together, and we'll see that in a second. So to make this easier to visualize, I've added some nodes after the Vellum Solver here. So the first thing I've done is added a split, and this is going to split up the particles according to whatever expression or group we put in here. So this is taking all the particles in phase one, and they will come out of one of these, and all of the particles that aren't in phase one, in other words, they have a phase value of two, will come out the other. And then I'm using two different color nodes to give them a different color, and then I'm merging them together. So we now see the colors here. And in fact, I've already cached out the simulation. So let me press play, and we can see what happens is that the red fluid, which is the thicker and heavier one, is accumulating at the bottom of the glass, and the lighter and less viscous fluid is accumulating at the top of the glass. Now, you may say that you can do that with flip fluids anyway. There is an advantage to using Vellum fluids for this kind of mixing fluid scenario, because it works on a particle-by-particle basis, so the edges between the different fluids will tend to be sharper. Whereas flip fluids, as you know, works on a grid, and therefore several particles are lumped together, as it were, when it comes to separating out the two fluids, so you'll get a less accurate division between the two fluids. So in general, if you've got a fluid mixing scenario, then vellum fluids are probably better and more accurate for that. So this is what it looks when rendered. So in this next example, we're going to look at the interaction between a fluid and what is in fact a vellum soft body. But what I'm doing here is modelling some ice. And then I'm using the vellum cloth and vellum struts nodes here to set up a very rigid soft body, so it'll behave more or less like a rigid body. And then I'm feeding this into a vellum solver. This is one vellum object. And I'm also feeding in the glass as a collision geometry. And then I'm sourcing from the sphere as we were before. But in this case, I'm not starting my sourcing immediately because I need the ice to fall down into the glass first. And if you get the weight of the ice or the soft body right, and the density is set up here, if you get that right, you can get the liquid and the soft body to interact such that the soft body floats on the top of the liquid. And I've simulated this out already so that we can see it working. So there's the liquid coming in, and you can see fairly realistically the ice floats on the liquid. And the same technique, by the way, will work for a vellum balloon. So next up, we're going to look at the interaction between fluid and vellum cloth. And this time I've just got a big sphere here, which I'm converting into fluid. I'm not sourcing. This big ball of fluid is just going to fall down, and it's going to fall on top of the cloth, which I'm creating using a planar patch. Now, the method here to create a cloth with a tear in it is covered in other videos, so I won't go through it in detail, but essentially I draw a curve on that planar patch. I then use an edge fracture node to produce the tear. I then set up it as a normal cloth object, and then I'm using this weld node to weld together those points that were torn. And by the way, here on the vellum cloth, I have a group set up of the corners of this cloth, and those are being pinned to animation here, which means that the cloth won't just fall down because the corners are pinned. Now, because we've got two vellum objects that are going to interact, I need to merge together the two bits of geometry, which I'm doing here. The first output of each of these is going into here, and then the constraints from each of them is going into this merge node here, and then I'm going to connect the geometry to the first input, the constraints to the second input, and let's see what that happens. So the liquid falls down, the tear breaks, and there we have it. So let's look now at the vellum brush and how that works with fluids. You may have seen the vellum brush being used with vellum cloth, where it's very useful to manipulate the cloth, fold it up, crease it, and so on. Well, it works with fluids as well. So let's lay down a vellum brush and connect the geometry to the geometry, the constraints to the constraints, and our tank into the final input. And as you can see, as with some of the new tools in Houdini 19, it has this helpful help screen on the left-hand side. You can get rid of that by pressing Shift F1 to bring it back. So the way it works with fluids is that you need to keep your shape generally on screen, and it has a few different modes which work with fluids. The first one I'll demonstrate is a brush, and what this does is simply drag the particles of your fluid around. You can also contract and expand your fluid. You can see that that's contracting the fluid. And you can rotate bits of the fluid like so. And to get rid of the changes, you can click Reset All Changes up the top. You can also add pins. Obviously this is more normal with cloth, but you can do it with liquids, and you can shift middle click to add a pin, turns blue, and then when you try to, let's put this back on brush, when you try to manipulate the fluid, the bit that's pinned doesn't move. So there are a few things that you can control here to change the effect. One of the things is to increase the number of frames being simulated, and in general that will cause your particles to fly further. There are other ways to do that, however. Here on the Forces tab, there are two controls which serve to sort of damp, let me reset all of this, which serve to sort of damp down the effect of the force. One is timescale, so this is making the reducing the effect of the force over time. So if I change that to 1, you can probably just see that it's throwing the particles further. And then let's revert that to defaults. The other thing you can do is change velocity damping. If I reduce that to 0, you can see that it's producing a lot more effect. One of the things you can change is the simulation mode. By default it's on damped, so there's a sort of drag force on your throwing of particles and they eventually peter out, but you can also change it to settle. And if you tick live simulation and you've got gravity enabled, you can see this is all flowing down and hitting the bottom of your tank. So let me reset all changes, change this back to settle, and I'm going to turn off live simulation before it gets too far. And now you can see that each time I make a move, it's simulating. Here I've increased the number of frames to 5, and it's simulating 5 frames after every brushstroke. So you're seeing the effect of gravity after every brushstroke. So that's the difference between the settle and the damped form of the brush. So this brings us to the end of looking at some examples for Vellum fluids. In the next video, we'll have a look at the minimal solver.